In talking about group psychotherapy, I take as my model the method which I originated over 30 years ago and have developed ever since. It has been called group analytic psychotherapy, and in order to explain its nature, it is best to make some comments on his name. The term analytic refers to the fact that I approached this field as a psychoanalyst of long experience, and that all the assured knowledge which we owe to psychoanalysis is fully taken into account. As a pupil of Kurt Goldstein, I brought with me the insight that any situation in which we operate decides all the processes which we observe. In the case of a group, it is therefore the group itself, the group situation, which we must take as our frame of reference. The term psychotherapy was used in order to make clear that we are not dealing with a psychoanalysis in a group setting. This would in any case be a contradiction in terms, as psychoanalysis is a process confined to two persons, the psychoanalyst and the patient. Therefore, group analytic psychotherapy was chosen to express that this is a form of psychotherapy based on the group and on analytical foundations. The observations made and impressions formed could not easily be incorporated into the existing psychoanalytical theoretical structure, nor were they covered by current psychoanalytical procedure. Yet, within the sphere and compass of psychoanalysis itself, the minute study of the relatively isolated individual on biological foundations, its theoretical framework was adequate and should not be tampered with. According to my convictions, I therefore turned to a new situation which was likely to demonstrate and test these observations in operation and to lead to new concepts in order to make them intelligible. If I wish to refer to the whole discipline, theory and practice, to the whole system, I refer to it in short as group analysis. My interest in the possibility and potential of an analytical approach to a number of patients together at the same time, thus arose from my work as a psychoanalyst, seeing patients individually 5 times a week, day by day, over a number of years, one after the other, for an hour. I could not help thinking very often, what would happen if these different patients could meet each other and see how very different the ways are with which they are dealing or not dealing with certain fundamental problems which they all had in common. I wondered how they would influence each other, how they would react to each other, how they would handle the situation between each other if no one of them was in the particular role of the trained analyst, using his particular method, but in which they would act as free agents according to their own nature and their own lights. My first actual experience took place many years later. This was at the beginning of the Second World War, but in private practice, and any consideration of saving time or being under pressure of time, and for that reason, seeing a number of people together played no part whatever in this. When at long last I assembled my first group in a waiting room in Exeter, I was extraordinarily impressed by the liveliness and freshness with which these people, my patients, related to each other, talked to each other, threw light onto each other's problems, and also very soon by the astonishing pace of the progress they made. At the beginning I felt that I had relatively very little to do for this to come about, except having created the opportunity. Ever since, I have spent the greater part of my professional life and of my thinking in trying to clear up what it was that was happening in this group, which caused so much change and also brought so many new facets into the treatment situation. Gradually, a method developed to its present state, and it was necessary to operate with new ideas and a new theoretical frame work in order to do justice to these new experiences. I thought afresh about the essential nature of a therapeutic situation, designed so as to provide the optimal conditions for psychotherapy under any prevailing circumstances. Formal arrangements, informal arrangements, administrative matters, preferred mode of communication, interpretations, the attitude towards unconscious processes and meaning, towards resistances and defenses, the personality and prejudices of the therapist, naturally the nature of the patients and their troubles, and many other conditions they bring with them, all of this known and unknown, which may influence the procedure, is comprised under the term of situation. Any such situation, precisely defined and consistently conducted within the spectrum of the principal factors involved and the specific processes operating in it, was termed a T situation. T stands for therapeutic, in our case psychotherapeutic, and includes transference in its wider sense. Being an analytic situation, in our case, the therapist considered it in the spirit of a transference situation. This use of the symbol T was long before certain experiential groups became known as T groups, but the symbol can be extended to include those. Now, a fundamental principle is that this situation, whichever it is, psychoanalytic situation, face-to-face doctor-patient relation, the group analytic situation, whichever it is, decides what is going on and what presents itself for observation. Therefore, one must consider this total situation as the ultimate and basic frame of reference as to the meaning of what is being observed. In the group situation, or more specifically, the group analytic situation, the group as a whole represents this ultimate frame of reference. But let us be quite clear that there was never any question but that the individual patient, the individual member of such a group, was in the center of our attention, and that the psychotherapeutic treatment is conducted solely and exclusively in the interests of the individuals concerned. I have sometimes expressed this in the terms that the individual is treated on the background of the group as a whole, and that everything that goes on and is communicated is part of a total group context. Speaking more particularly of group analytic psychotherapy, it is furthermore significant that the group itself operates as the main agency of change. It turned out that the principles, even if they were only these two so far mentioned, can be applied and have been applied to very different situations, as for instance at the neurosis center of the British Army during World War II at Northfield, Birmingham, eventually leading to the therapeutic community idea inside the community at large, in industry, and in all spheres of life, in education, and what may especially interest us here, also in teaching, particularly in teaching psychotherapy and group psychotherapy. Even in the narrower field of group psychotherapy, we must sharply differentiate between the situation which I have just described, in which we treat individuals inside the group situation, and another one in which the group is treated for its own sake as a group, as, say, might be the case in industry. In such circumstances, the conductor places emphasis on the group itself. For instance, he may address his interpretations more to the group as a whole. It is in relation to this latter type of group that I have said once or twice, if you look after the group, the individual looks after himself. This is undoubtedly true, as we have proved in looking after a whole hospital, or each of us after his own ward of patients as a group. This is correct, but it has often been misconstrued into thinking that in group analytic psychotherapy itself, the intention is to treat only or mainly the group as a whole. This, as you will soon see in more detail later, is not so. I've just used the term conductor, which I prefer to that of leader, for the group analyst, for the simple reason that he is not essentially acting as a leader, whatever his presence and his functions may be, as we shall soon see. In a sense, he is continuously concerned with directing the group to its own best benefit, but he only very occasionally would be likely to give a lead in the usual sense of the term. We will have to speak more extensively of the conductor and his function on another occasion. For the moment, we will have to concentrate on the group as it needs to be constituted. What are the conditions under which it meets, and what happens? Let us first consider what our ultimate aims are. What do we really hope to achieve and very often succeed in achieving? I would say it is not only the lasting removal and dissolution of neurotic anxieties, blocks and inhibitions, or whatever the symptoms may be, but the liberation, the basic internal liberation of the individual, enabling him to achieve the fullest and optimal personal development of which he is capable. He will not only learn to think for himself, to feel for himself, to free himself from unnecessary anxieties and symptoms, but will and should be able to do justice to his creative ability, to see meaning and sense in his life, whatever its nature may be. These are the aims of our form of psychotherapy. In this way, it becomes clear also that full access to unconscious processes and to the many forces of conflict to which we are subjected is of fundamental importance in group analysis. This is in contrast to other forms of group psychotherapy, which are essentially designed to help, alleviate, and encourage people to make them freer up to a point in their social behavior. We discern groups which were called open, that is to say, with rapidly changing membership, and closed ones, that is to say, groups which begin and end with the same composition. The open group with rapid change has proved of the greatest value in my experience under inpatient conditions or outpatient hospital conditions at big centers, where people waiting for treatment can join such groups in what was termed the living waiting list, where they can be further diagnosed dynamically so that they can be with more accuracy placed into suitable vacancies. The open group has therefore its main value as a diagnostic group. The fully closed group is difficult to maintain, except again in large centers, under inpatient conditions, and when its total duration is limited and predetermined. The group, however, which has formed the most important in private practice and under outpatient conditions is what has been called the slow open group. The slow open group is composed of the same members over considerable periods, and in that respect resembles the closed group. But members terminate their treatment according to their individual situations and individual decisions reached, and the vacancies so arising are filled by new patients. I should like at this point to mention that in talking here of the slow open group, the usual outpatient standard all-round analytic group, I leave out of account certain problems which may be too severe and patients who may be too ill to be treated in an ordinary group of this sort, but who may very well benefit by participation in specially selected groups. This refers, for instance, to active psychotic patients or addicts of a severe kind and so forth. There are also special problem groups like couples with marital problems and many others who are a good instance for the use of the closed group. Other category are the combined groups in which individuals were seen regularly in individual interviews in addition. This should apply to all the members and at regular intervals, or only in an emergency as an exception. This latter needs no explanation. With a greater experience, and since groups have been held twice weekly instead of the former once weekly, there is hardly ever the need for this combination. Indeed, there is hardly the need to see any patient individually alone. There is still possibly a particular indication in some patients for such combination of treatment. On the whole, it is not desirable, especially in view of the desirability of having a unified therapeutic situation shared by all and a unified transference situation. Inevitably, in combined groups, the therapist is much more in the center and has, as it were, a special personal relationship with each member which the others do not share. Originally, we discerned mixed groups, mixed referring to sex, as by distinction to only male or only female groups. These latter, however, have a place only under very special conditions, when the problems are particularly used as a selective principles. It is nevertheless interesting to note that Paul Schilder, who roughly at the same time started group psychotherapy, of a very much more controlled type in the USA, still mentioned in his account, in his book on psychotherapy, that for obvious reasons he does not mix sexes. We nowadays work almost as a matter of course with groups of mixed sex. All the groups we considered have a fixed time of 1.5 hours, meet once a week or for more intensive treatment, and very much preferably twice weekly. And when they meet, they sit in an informal circle. Such a group consists of 8 participants apart from the conductor, 4 men and 4 women. It is not possible to do justice to the individual if the number is larger. In fact, interestingly enough, I have found a distinct difference between a membership of 7 and 8. In favor of a group of 7. Nevertheless, a group of 8, apart from the desirable equality of the sexes, is always part of the time reduced to 7. When patients leave and new ones join, or when someone is absent, although this rarely happens with increasing experience. Thus we ask 8 as the basic number. The usual diagnostic categories are freely mixed. Indeed, the more so, the better. Neuroses, character disturbances, borderline types of psychotics, especially schizophrenics, depressives, treatable forms, well-motivated forms of, say, addiction, homosexuality, etc., can all very well be mixed together. It is significant and interesting that it is more important to watch that there is not too great a range in such factors as age, intelligence, marital status, educational background, the whole walk of life, and all sorts of factors of this kind, which are social and cultural rather than biological. Regularity of attendance and punctuality are expected. There are no physical contacts, no smoking, no particular use of action methods. Of great importance for analytical reasons is that such a group has no connection in life with each other. They must not be friends or in the same firm or socially known to each other or neighbors and so forth. Equally well, they must not form such relationships while they are members of an ongoing therapeutic group. All these conditions must be taken with a grain of salt, of course. For instance, when people come and go to the session, and from the session, they naturally talk to each other, or they walk to the same station together. Nevertheless, it is recommended to be fairly strict in avoiding any unnecessary contact. More important is the fact that all these requirements are not introduced by way of four of us laid down by the therapist. The new entrant in an ongoing group need hardly be introduced to these conditions, as he sees them and understands them as tradition. But when introducing them, it is the best way to do so as soon as the first occasion arises for each. This happens pretty soon and has the advantage that the group can learn to understand the reason for these restrictions and can be introduced into the need to look analytically on what is going on and to refrain from acting it out too freely. In these respects, the conductor is basically an administrator. He introduces his conditions and watches over them, but contrary to any other administrator, he is continuously taking the dynamic significance of these measures into full account. Take, for instance, fees, which, by the way, are preferably kept equal for all members. Delay in paying them, feelings about them, all of this is fully discussed when any special reason or difficulty arises. As to the discussion itself, the group is given complete freedom. They are given to understand that they not only can, but should bring forward anything that enters their minds and which they are thinking about and feel like talking about. This leads to what I have described as free-floating discussion. I was for a while trying to bring it nearer, if possible, to the free association in individual psychoanalysis. This, of course, cannot possibly take the form of the individual situation, but I found that there is a free enough flowing of associative ideas going on spontaneously, as a sufficiently uncensored discussion, uncensored talk, if one introduces the right climate and atmosphere into the proceedings. There are anyhow, and of greater importance even, the unknown, the unconscious associations, the unconscious links and implications in between what is being talked about. These take the form sometimes of observations, elaborations, confirmations, or interpretations. Unconscious interpretations are very important. So are reactions against or defenses against what is being said, even though not consciously understood. We will later see that it is important for the conductor's orientation and his intervention to gauge the level of regression on which the group moves from the nature of these various responses to the ongoing themes. Such a discussion takes as a rule very lively forms, even dramatic and sometimes also funny forms. Severe blocks, like long silences, seem to occur, but very rarely when the conductor is experienced. When they do occur, as with any other blocks or disturbances or inhibitions in communication, it is of great importance to elucidate and to analyze their meaning. We find that all the positive, constructive, supportive elements occur in our groups in the same way as they are described in certain forms of encounter groups. But the very great difference is our interest in the unconscious communication and our endeavor to bring to light and to solution conflicts which in their original meaning are very far from the knowledge of the patients. It is true that this taking into account of the unconscious processes makes this analytical treatment considerably longer, but also definitely more intensive, and in fact a totally different matter from purely existential groups or action groups, which often bridge over the most decisive anxieties by defensive bonhomie. We find that the three most important areas of experience which the patient brings with him are: 1. His original network in the family, which is largely internalized and which comes into the group by way of repetition and transference. 2. His current network, relevant persons in his present life with whom he is concerned, be it in the family, amongst friends, at work, and so forth. 3. What is going on under our eyes in the ongoing treatment situation, in the here and now, as it has been called. Let me again repeat that in all this, the conductor makes the group, all its members, the most active part in the ongoing process, the most important agent of change. When speaking about the conductor in more detail, more can be said about how this is achieved, or better, how a conductor avoids preventing this from happening, which of course he should not do. The termination of treatment is usually in good agreement with the feeling of the patient concerned and also the group as a whole. We must of course allow for the fact here that the group always tends to keep on a member and not to let them go for a variety of reasons. Exceptions to this, so-called dropouts, happen now only in the first 5 or 6 sessions. There are 3 or 4%, and the number could be reduced if one didn't give some patients deliberately the benefit of the doubt. These dropouts sometimes gain from their short participation, or can be placed in a better way. I have never seen any harm resulting from them. Naturally, they are undesirable in great number, as they elsewhere seem to happen, because of the group itself. I understand that in other very well-known institutions, the percentage of dropout reaches 30 or even 40%. I do not understand how there can be such a great difference in our experience in this respect, as the groups in the institutions concerned are frequently conducted by excellent and very experienced therapists. I suspect that it has something to do with the emphasis practiced there, as for instance in the Tavistock Clinic in London, on the treatment of the group as a whole, on the almost exclusive concentration on group interpretations and in particular transference interpretations. In replacing a patient who has terminated his treatment, one has to be careful not to replace him as a rule machine-like in the next session, and to prepare the group for the newcomer and see to it that there is not an unfavorable phase existing, as sometimes happens, for the acceptance of any newcomer. It is difficult to anticipate this always. I have seen this happen very occasionally and only discovered it afterwards from my attendance sheet. I could then see that two or three such dropouts happened in a short space of time of each other. Obviously, there were unfavorable conditions in the group for accepting a newcomer in the right spirit, which in this particular case I had not spotted. Apart from these dropouts, there is another category of patients who terminate their treatment, sometimes even abruptly, without the agreement with the therapist or the group. This can happen any time, usually maybe after a year or two. I must say that I know of this experience almost entirely from supervision. I think this is because the more experienced person notices and analyzes this tendency to acting out, in particular this tendency of running away earlier and treated more adequately then. However, there is another aspect to this matter. Some patients can, by their very nature and disposition and the strength of their character defenses, not go as far as we would ideally wish in their analysis. These can often be spotted in preliminary interviews, but at any rate, the experienced conductor will become clear about these limitations soon enough in the course of the ongoing treatment. In such cases, it is possible to weigh up the advantages and disadvantages of prolonged treatment together with the patient, and to agree on terminating at an earlier phase of treatment than is usual or ideal. It is quite likely that if the situation is handled in this way, and it is indeed my experience, that patients of this kind derive what is for them the maximum benefit from their treatment, that they remain in a better state of equilibrium than if one had attempted to break down their defenses beyond what they themselves really wish. I have, by the way, seen such cases two or three times in the case of colleagues. These events could be termed premature or early leavers of a group. But they are totally different and happen at a totally different period from these dropouts. The way they do it when they succeed in surprising therapist and group by leaving, it's very often one of finding reality reasons or other rationalizations and refusing to see the defensive meaning of this, however clear it may be to the therapist and all the members of the group. It is important to analyze thoroughly with the group the effects of such an event, as there is a similar preparedness for reacting usually in quite a number of members, and for other reasons. A normal and satisfactory termination of treatment is anticipated in good time, so that group and individual leaving can react and analyze their reactions to losing this member and vice versa. The total duration of treatment is, under favorable conditions, between 2 and 3 years. I think we must guard against the tendency to overtreat and be too perfectionist, and more often than not can end treatment somewhat sooner than we would have thought. I think we should err rather on the side of treating less than we usually do. Another time we will speak on the group analyst, the conductor, and illuminate some of the basic principles of his directing such a group as this. While I was emphasizing that the group is the main agency, this does of course not mean that the conductor is unimportant or has nothing to do. Quite the contrary, he is after all the most important factor in such a group, and this apparent contradiction
I hope it will be possible to clear up